Hello, everyone. Today we're talking about The Selfish Gene by Richard Dawkins, a sci-fi classic that you'll probably regret not reading, even if you've never read it. I'm sure you've heard the term, The Selfish Gene. It's not just Dawkins' most famous work. It's a milestone in the field of evolution. It even made selfish gene a common phrase in the English language. Speaking of this book, it's really quite informative. It covers molecular biology, paleontology, animal behavior, game theory, anthropology, and more. But don't worry, you don't have to spend a lot of time wading through 370 pages of text. In this video, I'll quickly walk you through the core of the book and bring you up to speed on Dawkins' main arguments. Hello, and welcome to my bookstore. A good book a day will take you on a journey to improve both your thinking and your wealth. Below, we'll explore three main points together. First, what is what Dawkins calls the selfish gene? Second, what are the benefits of understanding this concept? And finally, if genes are indeed selfish, why do we still observe so much non-selfish behavior in nature? Let's explore the answers to these questions. Part 1. First things first, let's talk about what the concept of selfish genes really is. You might think that this name sounds very simple. It seems to imply that organisms have genes that cause them to behave selfishly. But the truth is, Dawkins means much more than that. He means that all genes are selfish. Every gene competes for its own survival, and that we complex organisms are just tools for genes to spread themselves. This may sound a bit overwhelming, but it is. It's a complete reversal of the idea that we usually think of natural selection as taking place at the individual level. To understand this idea, we must answer a question. What is the object of natural selection? There are two criteria. One is that the object must be able to reproduce itself, because only then it has the potential to spread and persist in nature. Second, this object must be stable enough so that natural selection has enough time to sift through it. Unfortunately, single organisms do not meet these criteria. Although organisms can reproduce offspring, but offspring are a mixture of genes from their parents, not an exact copy of the individual. And the life cycle of an individual is too short for evolution too. To support the long-term effects of natural selection, genes, on the other hand, fulfill these conditions perfectly. Genes are copied during cell division, and unless mutation occurs, they maintain their structural stability and are passed from one generation to the next. This makes genes the true unit of natural selection. To give you another example, imagine that the relationship between genes and organisms is like the relationship between a passenger and a ship. Genes, passengers, use organisms, ships, to travel the oceans of life. When they find a new ship, they jump ship. This is how genes continue to be passed on. This view challenges our commonly held notion of evolution, that organisms are the mainstay of evolution. This theory is supported at the cellular level. During sexual reproduction, genes are randomly assigned to germ cells through meiosis. In theory, this should be fair. But certain genes, such as the T gene in mice, the process can be manipulated to increase the chances that they'll be passed on, even if it's harmful to the host. This highlights the selfish nature of genes, that they're more interested in their own survival than in the well-being of the host. In short, when we say selfish genes, we don't mean that genes cause organisms to behave selfishly. We mean that genes themselves have evolved to be selfish. They are the true agents of natural selection. This is the central point that Dawkins is trying to make in this book. It is also a profound expansion of traditional Darwinism. Part 2. One might ask, what is the practical significance of the selfish gene hypothesis? What practical implications does it have? To answer this question, in his book, Dawkins lists a large number of miracles in nature. These phenomena can only be explained by using the selfish gene hypothesis in a more rational and tested way. Let's take an example from an insect, a vertebrate, and a human. Let's start with a social insect. We are familiar with social insects, including bees, ants, and termites. They all share the same characteristic. All members of a colony are born of a single mother. This mother is often referred to as the queen. The queen doesn't work. The only thing she has to do is reproduce her offspring. The males are in charge of mating. The females are divided into different types. Some look for food. Some raise it. Others are responsible for defense and fighting. These female insects, each with her own role, are known as jobbers. At a very early age, humans discovered that there is a strict hierarchy among these insects. The queen is superior and enslaves her children to fulfill her selfish desires. The worker beetles were selfless. Not only did they work hard, they would even sacrifice themselves if necessary. So is it true that job bugs exhibit this selflessness? According to Dawkins, Dawkins thinks it's still an illusion of selfishness. Not only are the bugs not slaves to the queen, but quite the opposite. They're actively feeding the fertile queens, driving the queens to be more fertile, so that they can better reproduce their genes. Let's see why. First of all, in both bees and ants, a queen will mate with a male only once in her life, and then she stores the sperm from that male mate for years to come, and then the queen lays eggs. These fertilized eggs develop into females. Most of the females become workers, and the unfertilized eggs develop into males. This gender system produces a very strange result. Because males develop from unfertilized eggs, they carry only one set of genetic material. This genetic material is 100% passed on to the sperm at the time of mating, and the queen carries two complete sets of genes. So there's only a 50/50th chance that each set will make it to a particular egg. In his book, Dawkins coined a concept called the relatedness index. It represents the probability that two relatives share a particular gene. As we just said, for a worker that develops from a fertilized egg, it receives from its father exactly the same genetic material as its sister. From the mother, 50% of the genetic material is the same. So it's obvious. The relationship index between the two sisters is 3/4, and the relationship index between each beetle and its mother is only 1/2. In other words, the relationship between the sisters is closer than the relationship between the sisters and their mothers. This is a very important conclusion. It means that the sisters are united and use their mothers as breeding machines. So the queen was influenced by the beetles to give birth to as many bugs as possible. And since jaw bugs are female, this is reflected in the sex ratio of the children. The female to male ratio is as high as 3-1. And this ratio is exactly the same as the sex ratio calculated by zoologists based on theories. It proves that the queen of social insects is, in fact, the queen of jobbies. More specifically, the selfish gene in the insect. The selfish gene makes sense in insects. So let's look at the higher organisms, the vertebrates. Let's talk about family planning in animal populations. I'm sure you're all familiar with the term family planning, but not many people know that there is family planning in nature. So how did family planning come about in nature? There's a famous Malthusian law in sociology. This law says that in the absence of intervention, population grows in a geometric progression. And once the population exceeds the limits of resources, the excess population will be eliminated. This law does not only apply to humans. It also applies to all kinds of animal populations. Zoologists have observed that populations such as lemmings and Canadian bobcats have no way to control their populations. And as a result, they go on a breeding spree when resources are plentiful, and then they starve to death when the resources run out. But in addition to them, other animal populations have mastered the method of actively regulating the number of their members. If we watch some birds in nature, we find that when the population is small, they'll raise more babies. And if the population is overcrowded, they'll voluntarily reduce the number of eggs they hatch. How does this work? British zoologist Vaughan Edwards proposes that when faced with resource constraints, these birds will voluntarily limit the number of eggs they lay. For the benefit of the whole population, they'll voluntarily limit the number of babies they can have. But that's hard to justify, because birds that are willing to sacrifice, they're bound to be replaced, would be replaced by a more willing breeder. Dawkins believes that only the selfish gene hypothesis can explain this phenomenon. As noted above, the selfish gene hypothesis suggests that natural selection occurs only at the level of genes. Animals need only maximize the benefits of the genes they carry at all times. But for genes, although in theory the more children you have, the more children the gene has, the more successful it will be. But parenthood is hard work. Take the female chickadee, for example. She has to fly back to the nest every 30 seconds during the day to feed her chicks. Obviously, if the female allocates her limited food and energy to too many chicks, she'll end up with fewer survivors. So it's really a matter of how many kids to raise. Not too few, not too many. So there must be some way that genes control the way birds detect signals in nature, so that they can determine how many kids is the optimal number. How many children is the optimal number of children to have? Scientists have discovered that different birds have different ways of determining this. For example, starlings live in flocks. For female starlings, the number of members in a flock can be judged by how loud the birds' calls are at their roosts. In other words, if a female starling notices that the birds in her roost are calling loudly, she will think that there are too many members of the flock, that it's a sign of starvation. She'll reduce the number of eggs she hatches, and vice versa. So how reliable is this theory? Scientists designed an experiment. They played two different recordings of two flocks of starlings during the same breeding season. In the first recording, the starlings were chirping very loudly. In the second set of recordings, there was very little chirping. The result was not surprising. The group with the loudest calls laid significantly fewer eggs than the other group, was significantly lower than in the other group. To take this line of thinking further, it also perfectly explains another phenomenon in nature. Animal Planet often shows flocks of birds flying over swamps. For a long time, people didn't understand why birds would flock together on purpose. But now we know that many birds regulate the number of eggs they lay by the calls of other birds, so that they can lay more eggs. So they can lay more eggs and other birds can lay fewer eggs. Selfish genes need to pretend to their rivals that they have a high population density. So every bird gathers together and chirps as loudly as possible to interfere with the judgment of other birds and, ultimately, to take more of the resources to produce their own offspring. So that's why, although family planning appears to be a sacrifice made by the individual for the population through self-discipline, it's still genetically selfish behavior. Let's take a final look at the selfish gene hypothesis. Does the selfish gene hypothesis apply to humans? We say that parental love is the deepest. Next is brotherly love, and then the love of other relatives. And the level of care varies greatly from one relative to another, and the degree of care they show can vary greatly. Dawkins thinks it has something to do with genetic selfishness. Take the kinship index we just talked about, is the probability that two relatives have the same gene. So, the relatedness index between a parent and a child is 1/2. And for brothers, it's also 1/2. But taking into account the possibility of half parents or half fathers, so the average index between brothers will be less than 1/2. So for everyone, parents are closer than brothers. As for the kinship index between third cousins in a family, is as low as 1/128, close to the level of strangers. This difference in relatedness index is perfectly consistent with how close people are to their various blood relatives. This suggests that kinship between organisms is also regulated by selfish genes. Part 3. Dawkins uses game theory to explain that cooperation in nature is not purely selfless or altruistic behavior, but part of the strategy of selfish genes in a long-term game. Through the concept of the prisoner's dilemma, we can understand that even selfish genes can promote cooperation and mutualistic symbiosis among organisms under certain conditions. For example, animals like gorillas and birds groom each other and remove parasites and get rid of parasites. Their behavior seems selfless. But in reality, this kind of mutual aid is the result of many games of chance. Long-term cooperative relationships may lead to greater survival advantages. Robert Axelrod's research shows that, in repeated games, an eye-for-an-eye strategy is often the most effective. This strategy not only requires participants to retaliate after being cheated, but also emphasizes that they should return to cooperation as soon as the opponent returns to cooperation. They should return to cooperation as soon as they are betrayed. A vivid example of this is the relationship between cleaner fish and larger fish. Cleaner fish help bigger fish get rid of parasites and thus get food. This mutually beneficial behavior is based on trust and recognition. Cleaner fish identify themselves through special patterns and behaviors, and the fish learn to recognize these signals to avoid being fooled by imposters. The stability of this relationship is based on the fact that both parties derive sustainable benefits from their cooperation. Deception by either party can lead to a breakdown in the partnership, and in the end, both parties lose. Through these examples, Dawkins shows that what is called altruistic behavior in nature is actually a way for selfish genes to reproduce themselves through sophisticated strategies in complex ecosystems. This seemingly altruistic behavior is actually part of a gene's long-term evolutionary strategy to maximize its spread and survival. To summarize, this is the complete introduction to the book in this video. Let's conclude by summarizing. First of all, the author dispels the illusion that humans are self-centered. The author points out that humans, like all other living things, are merely carriers of genes. Organisms exist only to reproduce and pass on their genes. In some extreme cases, genes can even harm the organisms that carry them in order to spread themselves. This is the selfish gene hypothesis. And second, the selfish gene hypothesis opens up a whole new way of looking at nature. With this hypothesis, we can give more concise and beautiful explanations for complex phenomena in nature, such as family planning. Finally, the authors argue that, although genes are selfish, this doesn't mean that nature is full of selfish behavior. This is due to the fact that nature has a large number of situations where the game is repeated an irregular number of times. In such situations, selfish genes can also evolve altruistic behavior. Well, that's it for this book. If you like our video, feel free to like, subscribe, and forward it to your friends. You're also welcome to share your thoughts in the comments section. See you in the next time.